All right, fantastic. Hi, everyone. Good morning. My name's Ellie, but I made an unfortunate decision when I first published to publish under Eleanor. So, like, everything comes as Eleanor, even though no one calls me that apart from my mum when she's angry. My pronouns are she, and if you want to find me online, you can find me on most platforms as Ellie the Element. Some of you last night might have seen my poster. It looked a bit like this, but smaller and printed on paper rather than digitally projected. And my poster talks about a little bit about narrative constructions of science in tropical environments and how it was less good than the science that was done in non-tropical environments, and how that played out in some of the museums that I look at for my PhD. So I had some example objects here. And the conclusions really were that, like, by overlooking where science is done on Earth, so places that we do space science, like the tops of mountains in places like Hawaii, and like high altitude deserts like the Atacama Desert, but also spaces where we collect things like meteorites like Oman, and land that used to belong to or like still belongs to indigenous peoples, such as in like Hawaii, but also Australia. We overlook like some of the aspects of like we overlook some like placemaking that we could do within like Earth space rather than trying to understand space on like humanities terms. The reason why I'm not very familiar with this is not actually like the main part of my PhD. This was something I was trying out for this conference because I'm interested in how like place plays into space. And that comes kind of from Lisa Miseri's work where she talks about making places in outer space. So actually the bulk of my research is a comparative case study, like a comparative research piece between three galleries in London that all address space science, kind of broadly constructed between astronomy, technology. And these are the Weller Astronomy Galleries in the Royal Observatory at Greenwich, the From the Beginning Gallery, which focuses mainly on planetary science in the Natural History Museum, and the Exploring Space Gallery in the Science Museum. So I look at the ways that we construct narratives in those spaces. And by narrative, having had this discussion yesterday, I was thinking about this on the way in. I use narrative to mean kind of like what kind of maybe like grand narratives in like the Lyotardian sense are we constructed, and how could we change those or challenge them using like the methodologies that I take. So I situate my work in a queer feminist methodology, but I'm really part of the reason I wanted to try talking about these like spaces is that I want to also focus on like the intersection of location and indigenous knowledge, as well as what we might think of as like more Western queer feminist perspectives. And I try to take a critical pedagogy approach, so looking at like what is the discourse that we put out as public education, and what does that do to shape the way that we think about the world around us. So my research questions are like, what kind of gender and narrative, gender and sexuality narratives exist within these London Space Science Galleries? By looking at what is there and thinking about the absence of things, so taking that idea of like the queer being what is left out of the discussion, how can we understand like why or what has been left out of those things? And what kind of what roles might alternative approaches to like power, futurity in the gallery do to challenge how we talk about space science? I recently wrote an article because I don't have very long for today. I recently wrote like a blog article type thing, popular science article about the construction of the future in space science galleries. And I looked at these three examples in particular. This is a little deck chair on Mars on the very right-hand side. It's got like a little candy striped deck chair like you might find on the beach. And it's got a bucket and spade and some sun cream, very like reminiscent of like the nuclear, like working middle class families' holidays in kind of British railway posters of maybe like the early 1900s. We also have the pioneer plaque here, and we have these two people in it. Again, looking at what we might think of as quite a heteronormative couple, where like the genders that they're assigned by NASA are also like closely tied to their biological sex. So you see also like a cis normative, like heteronormative couple here. And finally, this is a picture from a still in, like a picture from a video that's at the Royal Observatory Gallery that's like the starting point of thinking about space. And it is like probably a man. There is no like, there's no like signifying non-male traits about this person, and in the way that we think about, like, perhaps emojis being read as male if they're not explicitly female. This is the same kind of thing. And also, even though the line drawing style is with this white outline, because the entire person is colored in white, there's also, like, the implication of reading this as a white person as well, encouraged also by, like, the white voice sound over. And you can just see the elbow here, but there's a white BSL signer as well. So constructing not only, like, cis heteronormativity and, like, the nuclear family, but also, like, whiteness in this gallery. And this is for a piece that was kind of prompted by this, that was at the Future Starts here at the Victoria and Albert Museum. If Mars is the answer, what is the question? And so part of what I was arguing in this piece, and you can read it in full because it's a bit longer, the, like, URL is here if you want to take a picture of it, is that by creating legible places in outer space, these exhibits often limit the future to the experiences of the mainstream, which leaves out representation of queer and other marginalized identities and poses the question of exactly who has the right to such futures. So I think that's really important that we challenge particularly space science galleries, because we're constructing like an aspirational or futuristic idea of what this place might be like. And that at the moment we construct these in a very normative manner. The final section of my PhD is based on some tours that I did last year. It's called Queering the Science Museum. I got some funding from the BSHS through their, like, outreach grant to run this. And this was some feedback that I got from one of my participants. And in general, lots of people who came on the tours said that they, I've actually got some quotes here, said that they hadn't really experienced anything like this before. Lots of people didn't know any of the stories. We talked a little bit about Alan Turing yesterday, and he was one of the people who was featured on my tour. But over, like, 2/3 of the people who came on my tour only knew Alan Turing or didn't know any of the, like, 8 stories that we talked about on my tour. So there's a real lack of, like, knowledge about queer scientists and queer histories in science. So yeah, some of these like quotes were really encouraging. I was like, yes, doing something that, like, people aren't doing before. And they said, like, and I think that what was really interesting is lots of people who came either came because they were interested in queer history or they were interested in science. And most people had never thought about pulling these two things together. So that also told me that there's, like, a lack of understanding about how we can think queerly in STEM. These are all my lovely people who came on my tour. Yeah, I took some pictures so that I could prove to the BSHS that people actually came. most of our tours are really well attended. You'll notice down here there are 2 tours where there are just 2 people. The one on the far right, this was the day after Pride. Turns out, don't run queer things the day after Pride. And the other one was the day of the, like, World Cup fixture where England were in the semi-finals. Also, don't run anything that you want people to attend on those days. This, like, is quite a short talk, so I haven't had loads of time to explore kind of what it did. But as Ross held up yesterday, there was a special issue of the Viewpoint, the BSHS, like, magazine, and I feature lovely on the front cover mid-speech. So if you want to know more, I've written up my work so you can read a little bit more. I actually have a couple of issues because my supervisor went somewhere and took loads, and she was like, give them out. So if you would like a copy of this and you don't have it, I have some in my bag. But yeah, so I guess one of the conclusions I make is, like, by taking the queer position in the tour, unoccupied by the museum itself, the Queering the Science Museum tour introduced to the world, in the words of James Saunders, the small cracks and fissures in the heteronormative foundation of the museum, spaces through which the roots of new curatorial and educational performances may take hold. So I think that, like, hopefully by trying to do this, I'm showing that this is a thing that we can do in a way that we can communicate and educate within the museum space. From that, I've actually been involved in some other tours. I thought I'd tell you a little bit about other stuff that I do. I am currently a museum tour guide at the Victoria and Albert Museum. This is me talking about a Lolita dress. If you would like to hear me talk about this and you live in London, I'm doing my next tour on the 27th of July, so the last Saturday of the month at 4 p.m. I'm also a tour guide at the Scott Polar Museum in Cambridge. And this is a lovely review that I got in the Times. And so if you would like to read more about what I did, it's there. But this is some statistics from these tours. And I think this one's particularly interesting. I don't know if you can read it, but it says 53% of the people who came to these LGBT themed tours at the Polar Museum were first time visitors to the Polar Museum. So not only are we, like, introducing new audiences to these spaces, we're also telling new and different stories. And me with my dinosaur that has the same color hair with me down here is to symbolize that, like, right now as we talk, I'm writing the tours for the Whipple Museum for the History of Science in Cambridge, and also for the Sedgwick Earth Sciences Museum. So look out for some, like, queer tours going on there as well. However, I recognise museums are not super available to everyone, especially not London museums or Cambridge museums, because this is an international audience. So if you'd like to hear more about the way I think about objects, I also was given some money by UCL to run a podcast, which is on iTunes and also on my website. It's called Behind the Glass Cabinet, and it looks at alternative interpretations of objects in science museums in London. And yeah, had some lovely feedback from some of my listeners, and I'm currently writing this up for review for UCL at the moment. There are like 8 really interesting episodes, and I would recommend it to you all, but not because I'm like, because I would love like more listener feedback. So that was all I was going to say to you. Thank you so much for listening. It's been great to talk to you about my work. Thanks.